broadcasting the information the mainstream media won't touch. This is The Richie Allen Show, in association with DavidIke.com.
So I recorded Cynthia today, so you can tweet your brains out while I'm chatting with Cynthia, but because I recorded it, I won't be able to put any of your points to her. She's in Bangladesh, of course. Well, what can I tell you about Cynthia McKinney? She's a former Green Party nominee for the presidency of the United States. She's a two-time former congresswoman for the state of Georgia. And, of course, don't forget, she was the first African-American woman to be elected as a congresswoman for the state of Georgia. Amazing, amazing woman. Check out a documentary called American Blackout, which I think is on YouTube, which describes, well, it doesn't describe, it tells the story of how she was targeted. How she was targeted by the establishment because of who she is and because of her beliefs. She's an amazing woman. Last time we spoke with her was just over 6 months ago when she received her PhD, something she's rightly very proud of. She lives in Bangladesh these days. I caught up with her earlier on, and of course the first thing I asked her was, how the hell are you? How have you been since we last spoke?
Well, I wish I could say I were doing better, but I would be doing better if my country were doing better. But in the middle of the 2016 presidential election, oh my gosh. I mean, it's just absolutely ridiculous. But I've got to put a request in to you. I now have a radio show on KPFK, which is a Los Angeles Pacifica Network station. So I want to interview you sometime.
I'll tell you what, I'd be honored. I'll tell you what,
okay,
David Icke is going to be in Los Angeles, right? So I'm going to try and arrange you to have a chat with David on your show, because he's going to be speaking in Los Angeles in a few weeks' time. He might give me a smack now for adding yet another interview to his schedule, but he loves you anyway. So let's organize that for a start, right?
Okay.
And congratulations on the show, by the way. Wonderful.
Okay, so let me know what's up.
Absolutely. And
okay.
After the program, or during the program, I'm going to tweet out links to where people can hear your show on that station. That's great news, by the way. One of the things we wanted to do in London a few years ago was to get you to do a TV show. Before we could get anything done, all of that ended. But there you go. It is crazy, Cynthia, what's happening in the United States. And I'm going to ask you a question, and I don't want to mention anybody specifically because they're not here to defend themselves. But are you horrified that certain elements of the US so-called alternative media are supporting Donald Trump? What's going on with that?
Well, I'm not horrified at all. I'd like to know who those alternative media types are. I mean, you know, if you just take a look at of course, he said some outrageous things. And the Islamophobia and twisting the 911 story to talk about celebrating Muslims when everyone knows that it was the Israelis, the dancing Israelis, who were spotted celebrating the destruction of the Twin Towers. And then a group were arrested and Bolo was put out a be on the lookout. Police directive was put out for Middle Eastern looking, whatever that is, men. So anyway, there's that whole thing and sort of twisting, a spinning of the actual events. But in terms of getting the Europeans, getting you guys, not necessarily you guys, especially after Brexit, but getting the Europeans to pay for NATO, yeah, that's a darn good thing. And we haven't had anybody to talk about that for 50 years. Talking about the wars and how the United States needs to take care of home, well, we haven't had a candidate to really seriously discuss that for how many presidential elections now? And that's because they all are tied to the Israeli lobby. And the Israeli lobby is pushing all of these wars. So that's on two counts that he is definitely on the right track, saying necessary things. He also has criticized the trade agreements that starting with NAFTA, which was a sort of a Clinton era trade agreement, right on up to TTIP, which is for you Europeans, and to make sure that you guys stay on the U.S. plantation. And then there's TPP, which is the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which is intended for Asia. And so basically, those trade agreements have decimated areas of the South and the Midwest, cities in the South and the Midwest, in terms of employment opportunities for American people. And as far as I'm concerned, the policy pronouncements that Donald Trump has made are actually right on target and are far better than anything that we would get from Hillary Clinton.
But there's a big but, though, and that but is, does he... The big but is, does he even know what he's saying? Does he even understand some of these pronouncements he makes? Because he comes across sometimes to me as just an eccentric kind of buffoon type character who shoots from the hip and says whatever is really on his mind. And that's at that particular time, that is. And I can't argue with you when you hear him talk about, you know, drawing down America's involvement overseas and getting Europe to pay for NATO and all of that. All of that sounds wonderful. But how much of it does he actually understand, and how much of it does he really mean? You see, these are serious questions, aren't they? Because then on the other hand, you have all these Islamophobic statements. You have this black and white view of the world. There are crazy people in the world trying to kill us. Therefore, we have to stop them getting to America. We have to deport people. All of that nonsense, which kind of led me to believe, and still does, that he's been kind of more of a stalking horse for Hillary Clinton since he... Because I would imagine to middle America, Trump is just completely unpalatable. And I won't argue this, but I will put out there that maybe this was the plan all along.
Oh, well, I mean, we know how things operate, or how politics operates in Washington, D.C. So there is absolutely no doubt in my mind that there was some collusion, because even Bill Clinton has admitted to having a conversation with Donald Trump about running for the presidency prior to Trump's announcement that he was actually going to run. And, the relationship, the very close relationship between the Clintons and Donald Trump is one that is on the record. So the possibility for that kind of collusion, in fact, I believe that that is exactly the situation that happened in 2008, except that at that time, Madam Clinton got stabbed in the back, or I like to say she got left at the altar, and the crowd that surrounds Barack Obama just, you know, decided to take him on to the White House. At some point, at some time, there was a decision made that we're not just going to let him stand up next to Hillary on the debate platform. We're actually going to take him in. And, I have my ideas about who exactly made that decision. And the reaction that Bill Clinton gave in South Carolina, where he said this is just a fairy tale, bears some evidence to that kind of collusion that was admitted to by someone on Barack Obama's staff. This is some, you know, sort of inside information that I was able to glean. And so now you've got them playing the same game a second time, and it's very well possible that she could get left at the altar a second time. And as far as I'm concerned, that would be the best possible thing for the Democratic Party and for the political system of the U.S. at large. Never Hillary. Hashtag never Hillary. That's what I've been honing in on my on my social media. Facebook page, Twitter is all about how unfit Hillary Clinton is to be president of the United States? And how are we going to have someone who is a known assassin? How are we going to have that as a darn president of the United? Well, I mean, you know, it's not like we haven't had. But you know, she's just, why should she be rewarded in such a fashion for the crimes that she and now she's drug her family, her entire family, into the mix of criminal activity? I think it's a shame and it's outright disgusting. So, you know, Mumia Abu-Jamal said that if we have to have the choice between defeating Clinton, Hillary Clinton's neoliberalism, and selecting Donald Trump, then that is a choice that he is willing to live with. And so I think that if you combine the policy prescriptions of Donald Trump along with the downright horrors and dangers of Hillary Clinton, I think that, you know, there's a big but, and I agree with you that there's a big but. But Hillary Clinton has a bigger
a bigger butt.
I'm sorry.
I know it sounds wonderful. That's a wonderful soundbite. I'm going to use. No, I'm not going to use that soundbite. I'm going to hang you out to dry. Cynthia McKinney says that Hillary Clinton has a bigger butt than Donald Trump. We can't assume knowledge.
Well, let me just hasten to add.
Go on.
That I should know about big butts. Okay, so I'm not going to.
You're a gas woman, as we say in Ireland. Listen, I just got to mention, by the way, that Mumia Abu-Jamal, in case some of our listeners haven't heard of him, they should look him up. He's a terrific man, wrongfully convicted of a murder back in the early 1980s. He's an activist. He didn't do it. His trial was a disgrace. Find out all you can, folks, about Mumia Abu-Jamal, just in case you haven't heard of him. It was good that Cynthia brought his name up there. I hear what you're saying. You've said for years, because you've been a congresswoman twice, you've said for years, the answers to the nightmare paradigm we live in are not in the political system. You've always said that. And you're not endorsing Donald Trump or anything like it. But you're saying it might be the biggest wake-up call in the world ever to the people of the United States, if first of all, she paid for her crimes, wasn't elected, and second of all, they were left with him, they might start to realise that the game is rigged. Now, we can spend some time, by the way. Go on.
Here's a better way to put it, or at least not better for you know than your own words, but here's a better way that I can put it. Let me clarify my statement, and that is that the average person in the United States, that's my mother, my next door neighbor, and me now that I'm no longer in Congress, the average person in the United States has absolutely zero, nada interest in the current configuration or power configuration of the U.S. deep state. The U.S. deep state today serves only itself. And now we can get, you know, into another discussion about the change that has taken place in terms of the personalities that reside inside the U.S. deep state. So I believe, first of all, that these personalities that have newly come into the U.S. deep state are far more selfish, far more greedy than anything that we've seen in the past. And so even the people who normally were, you know, sort of made even tangentially or peripherally beneficiaries of that power configuration, well, that is no longer the case. And I think that's why you're seeing some of this reaction to Donald Trump, is that those hangers-on to the previous deep state power configuration have recognized that they've been dropped into the fat. They've been left in the wind. They are now twisting in the wind, and they are rejecting that status. So they now have joined those of us who have always been on the outside, right? And so now you have a powerful political situation inside the United States that allows for systemic change if
we recognize the moment that is at hand. Therefore, the situation is that the average ordinary American or U.S. resident no longer has any stake whatsoever in the current power configuration of the U.S., nor in its political expressions, its political system. Therefore, the behavior that would be most advantageous... Gosh.
Don't worry about it. You can, if you want to take a second to switch it off, do that. We'll carry on. This is the beauty of radio.
Yeah, just. Adam.
Right. While Cynthia is doing that, there, we'll briefly just give you a time.
No. Here. I'm back.
Are you back? Okay. No, I was just going to do. I was just going to do a time check. Go ahead.
Yeah. So basically, the behavior that would best suit the electorate in the United States is to see the total implosion of the current political system and the creation of a new system that's more responsive to the needs of the people of the U.S. That is what it would be most advantageous to the people of the U.S., to finally see their needs met, if it's possible. And so that means then that we have no stake in the success of the Democratic Party, and especially after what they did to Bernie Sanders and the collusion there to make sure that Hillary emerged as the nominee. So the Democratic Party, let that go kaput. Now, what Trump has successfully done is he's run away all of those nefarious characters that were in the underground of the Republican Party. They are now supporting Hillary Clinton. They fled the Republican Party. That's a darn good thing. So Republican Party kaput. Now, imagine if we could promote the Green Party and the Libertarian Party so that they could get 5% of the electorate. That moves them into major party status. And then you get that third tier now of political parties that could become second tier parties. And so I'm talking about the Constitution Party, the Independent Party, the Party for Socialism and Liberation. And then, you know, even perhaps the Peace and Freedom Party, which is in one state, but perhaps it could move to a nationwide status. So you begin to get the kind of change inside the U.S. political system that the people desperately need. So I've adopted the strategy ABC, anybody but Clinton. And that way, I'm encouraging people to support anybody who conforms to their particular needs, but not under any circumstances to support Hillary Clinton.
We could spend a lot of time on the crimes of Hillary Clinton, her husband, and the Clinton Foundation. We've talked a lot about them individually in the program in the last few weeks, even before I had a brief break there. Do you want to comment on the seriousness of the allegations? And of course, they've moved far beyond allegations, Cynthia, haven't they? The charges that should be brought against Hillary Clinton. We're talking about financial misdeeds going back years. We're talking about gun running. We're talking about drug running. We're talking about people disappearing. We're talking about recently, of course, it's emerging even that while she was Secretary of State, she was sharing confidential information with her son-in-law about the Greek debt crisis, which led to him making successful bets on the stock exchange. If the woman was to be prosecuted and convicted for her crimes, and if she was to serve consecutive sentences, not for a laugh, Cynthia, I'm not saying this for a laugh, she'd be in jail for 1,000 years, wouldn't she?
She'd be in jail for a very long time, and that's what justice demands. But here's the thing. I'm extremely happy to see Clinton justice put in the faces of the American people so that the whole country can see that there's no such thing as justice for Hillary Clinton. Because if she were anybody else, she'd already be up under the jail. But because she is who she is and she has the support of the people who support her, then we get this deformed type of justice called Clinton justice. That's what I call it anyway. Clinton justice. And it's in our faces. And the more it's in our faces, I believe the more we have the opportunity for the revulsion of the average ordinary voter who might be inclined to have a woman in the White House, but not that woman, and who might be inclined to vote for Hillary Clinton, but not anymore. So now, if we want to start talking about the crimes, I'm not going to even get into the most recent stuff, because all of that is the stuff that's in our faces, and the release now of, or the impending release of, an additional 14,900 emails. I can't wait to tear into those as well.
What do you think? Sorry to briefly interrupt you. What do you think we're likely to? What's the sort of stuff? What do you think the seams will be of those 14,000 plus emails? What will we get?
Well, I just want to talk about the crimes already that nobody is talking about.
Fair enough.
And I want to talk about the theft from the Haitian people of their own democracy, their right to name their own president, to go to the polls and cast a vote and have that vote actually counted for the person that they would like to lead them into the next 5 years. Now, that happened. Hillary Clinton intervened in the 2010 presidential election and robbed the Haitian people of their choice. And we know it because the chairman of the Haitian Presidential Election Commission made the announcement earlier this year, just a few months ago, that Hillary Clinton's chief of staff, who at that time was Cheryl Mills, a Black woman, went down to Haiti representing Hillary Clinton and the Secretary of State, read out the wrong name, and then use the power of the Secretary of State's office to put the wrong person in as president. The president of the Haitian Presidential Election Commission said when it happened, he was stunned, he was shocked. He shut up and didn't say anything and let it happen. So the people of Haiti saw some that they did not support, that they did not vote for, a Hillary Clinton put into the highest office.
We're just having a few sound problems there. Sorry to interrupt that, Cynthia. We're just having a few sound problems. You're just kind of breaking up a little bit and coming in and out. So you can't do anything about that. What I'm going to do is I'm going to briefly disconnect and reconnect and hope that it clears the decks, as it were. It sometimes works when you do that. And we get her back. Sorry about the sound quality just dropping out very briefly there. Since he is in Bangladesh, don't call me a racist. When I say Bangladesh, sometimes the internet speeds are not as quick in that part of the world. So there's a brief connection problem. It's telling me that it's trying to recover the connection between us both. Cynthia, I think you might be back. Sorry about that.
Yes, I am. And it's not Bangladesh. Let me just say that it's not Bangladesh. It is, but I do have a problem here. But we used to have a fiber optic line, which is why you could speak to me so clearly. And the fiber optic line got cut. And so now it sort of catches catch can. And that is the problem until we can get our fiber optic line back up again.
Oh, no, I understand. My apologies. I thought you were still in Bangladesh. No worries.
I am. Still in Bangladesh.
Oh, but it's not. All right, okay, fair enough. I'm with you. It's not the logistics in Bangladesh. It's something else.
That's right.
So I mean the Haitian high crimes on their own should be enough to see somebody indicted and to see somebody
right,
in front of a judge.
I'm not even finished, because then while the illegal resident of the Haitian presidency gave her brother a gold mine. The corruption is just in our faces. Gave her brother a gold mine, and the Haitians are still trying to get their gold back from when the U.S. occupied Haiti. So they have always said, we're not mining any additional gold because we want our gold back. And then the Clinton Foundation donors, they were given contracts to, as if, you know, Haiti was like a little, what, fiefdom or something?
Yeah.
So anyway, it was horrible, absolutely horrible experience. And that is exactly the way she would run the United States if she were elected president.
Can I just say this? You've listed all those things and you could have spent at least an hour doing it. Do you understand then why people like me, we're labelled conspiracy theorists. You understand why we believe that she will be president of the United States no matter what, because it has been preordained. And I'll tell you why, Cynthia. Because she is the woman that's going to lead a ground invasion of Syria. What do you think?
Well, President Obama's already done a good job of that. And so issued a couple of days ago a warning to the Russians that now the United States is actually going to start shooting down. Now that they don't have Turkey to do it any longer, they have to do it themselves. These people are absolutely crazy. I posted on my Facebook page, the lunatics now are totally 100% in charge. You let Hillary Clinton become president of the United States, and then, you know, they won't have to act surreptitiously. They will be in those positions once again. It will be even worse than President Obama is, and that's pretty bad. So, again, I promote my ABC strategy, which is anybody but Clinton. I'm hoping that the Democratic Party can suffer the same result as the Republican Party and have all the rats just running for cover someplace else, but leaving that boat as well.
I want to ask you about something else. I went to see with my fiance Caroline, the singer Morrissey, in Manchester on Saturday night last. He was back in town for the first time in a few years. The former singer of The Smiths, of course. Now, Morrissey has a song called Ganglord from an album a few years ago. And Ganglord doesn't represent a gangster or a gangbanger. The ganglord in the song is actually the police in the United States. And while the song is playing, the big screens in the arena are showing incidents of police brutality in different places in the United States, but they constantly update the video for the live show, for the live tour, because this sort of thing is happening all the time. It's brutal to watch. I mean, when you see these things on YouTube, when you see people, we had a horrible incident the other day where a gentleman who was deaf was shot and killed. This went viral. He was stopped for a traffic violation. He gets out of the car and he's making signals because he's deaf with his hands and he gets shot dead. It's absolutely brutal. We were talking about this before I went on my summer holiday. And I had a number of different people on. I had some people on who represent Black Lives Matter. I had some people on who don't like Black Lives Matter and think it's a politicised group and think that it's got the grubby paws of George Soros on it and all of that. What I've come to believe, Cynthia, and you know I'm a white Irish boy, and I've never experienced racism, ever. In terms of I've never been subjected to racism. I've never had to put up with anything like that. I've always believed, first of all, I believe that the police in the United States, there is a psychotic element to them. And we know they're hiring guys who are low IQ people. They've got low IQs, they're uneducated. We also know that many of them use steroids. We know that a lot of them are into the bodybuilding scene. And we know that they're incredibly aggressive. And I believe, and I've always, the evidence is there, that the black people are disproportionately treated badly by the police than white people. I believe that because I've seen the evidence of it. But I've also believed, Cynthia, that there is a hidden hand. And you know exactly where I'm coming from because you've spoken to me before. There is a hidden hand. There is, a very powerful shadowy elite who manipulate these race wars, who want us to hate one another. I don't mean you and me, but me and my Pakistani neighbors, me and my black neighbors. Because as long as we're kicking the living shit, excuse my bad language, out of one another and hating one another, we are not uniting to go after them, and they are a tiny amount of people. So I want to ask you about Black Lives Matters. Now, this is not a loaded question because I don't know very much about them. People have been saying to me that that particular group is being manipulated by the same hidden hand that wants us all killing one another. What do you know about these people?
Well, that's a very interesting question because I've watched from afar. I have had one sort of kind of debate about them. Now, you know, I happen to know one of the women professors. There's, I think, four women professors who actually started the organization. And I happen to know one of them. I happen to think that she's absolutely fabulous. But what actually does that mean? I mean, you know, when you say, okay, I just recently saw where they're getting millions of dollars. Now, you know, the issue for me, I do care about where the money comes from, but I also care about, you know, the stipulations that are attached to the money. And there are many organizations that are doing good work, that are doing necessary work. And I do believe Black Lives Matter is also doing necessary work. However, I would just feel better if our revolution was financed by us and not somebody else, you know? And so that does give me pause. So, there's a hidden hand. There's always a hidden hand. You understand that. The extent to which Black Lives Matter is, I think they're doing the right thing. In fact, I think they need to be doing more of what they're doing. You know, they ought to be surrounding police departments all over the country. There's a lot that they could do focused specifically on that issue. And to the extent that their mission is to continue activism around that issue, I think they're necessary. I think they're absolutely necessary because that issue is something that's been around ever since Black people have been inside the United States. And I'm talking about 1776.
And you know, posse comitatus has gone out the window, hasn't it? The police have basically been turned into the army in front of our eyes over the last few years. And they're out of control. Now, look, I don't live there. I absolutely stand by what I said. Black people are historically and have been disproportionately at the brunt end of the police nightstick and the gun. They always have been. I mean, black people are disproportionately sentenced as opposed to white people. We know this again. In certain states, you're five or six times more likely to be sentenced to life imprisonment or even the death penalty if you're black than if you're white. None of this is a lie. It's all absolutely true. But I believe that ultimately, and I said this, you won't believe, you probably will believe it. I interviewed former Ku Klux Klan guy David Duke on the program about 5 or 6 weeks back, because I wanted to impress upon him, you know, he was talking about running for Congress again, and guys like him are trying to paint themselves now as very respectable, serious political commentators, when of course they're not. He was a member of the Ku Klux Klan. Give me a break.
Wait now. You know, I'm from the South.
Yeah.
So I understand that. You don't have to be a member of the Ku Klux Klan to be a racist.
Oh, no, of course you don't.
And
no,
so,
no, no.
Wait. Let me say this because I think this is very important. I've spoken to Ku Klux Klan members, too, because I've represented them and I've been threatened by them.
Yeah.
But I've also seen them transform into different people. And so I am never going to say that people can't change. Because that ultimately is what life is all about, isn't it? It's about acquiring more information and then fine-tuning your positions to correspond to the new information that you have.
Yeah, you're smacking me on the wrist there. Maybe I deserve it. Maybe I shouldn't judge David Duke. My interview with him was very polite and very cordial. But it's this whole white Europeans are under attack and all of this nonsense that you get from people like him, you know. White Europeans are not under attack. We're all under attack, aren't we? And I think we might have just momentarily lost Cynthia there. So let me try and get her back. This is interesting stuff, by the way. Right, let's try and get her back. She just disappeared on us momentarily. Little bit of a connection issue. She's in Bangladesh. Sorry about that, Cynthia. We dropped out on one another again. My apologies.
Yeah.
Don't worry about it. These things happen. I was just making the point. You might very well be right to smack me on the wrist for making a judgment about David Duke. But it's ultimately the same narrative that white Europeans are under attack from radical Islam and from crime in the African American community, crime perpetrated against white European Americans. And it's intellectually redundant, that argument. I said to you many times over the years, well, you said to me, actually, we've been speaking on the radio now for about 9 years. We're all under attack from this hidden hand, Cynthia. Every single one of us are. We're all at the blunt end of it.
Yes, we all are. And, you know, now there are some people in the United States that would be shocked at the amount of anger and disgust and outrage that is experienced every day in the Black community. But it's not given voice and it's not given the opportunity to be expressed. But you give that the opportunity to be expressed, and I guarantee you people will be crying for Black Lives Matter to come back again. So, you know, you talk about hidden hand. It doesn't take much. When you're under the gun of repression and oppression, the way the Black community in the United States is, I don't care about President Obama. He's been worse for the situation than a part of the solution. But when you have that kind of situation, it's a simmer that could become a boil very easily.
You know what I'll say on that? I totally agree with that. And I spoke to a lovely young woman who attends Black Lives Matter rallies. She's a young Black woman in her early 20s a few weeks ago. I speak to so many people on the radio show, I can't remember the young lady's name, but it's a good interview and it's on YouTube. I'll actually tweet it out now while we're doing this. And I did say to her at the time, I said, look, obviously the majority of Black men and women who are attending these rallies are sick to death of the status quo and they want change. But beware of George Soros type manipulation, because what you get is you get these well-meaning organizations infiltrated by people. Before you know it, one or two people do some very bad things. And of course, that's exactly what they want, Cynthia. And then they want to discredit, you know, the 80, 90, maybe 99% of African-Americans who are coming out, holding a candle, attending a vigil, saying, look, we're sick of this. We've had enough of it. And I just say, beware of the money coming into the organization. Beware of where that's coming from and all of that.
Well, I've put out a little article about being wary of many things because of the lessons of COINTELPRO. So it's not just the money that's an issue. You could have a guy who is actually an undercover cop throw a Molotov cocktail and all of a sudden you've got, you know, bedlam breaking loose. So you've got the possibility of a militarily trained person who is filled with outrage and all of a sudden they start shooting and killing, you know, killing in what would ordinarily be a peaceful protest. So you can have all kinds of things take place and you don't, and it's not about the money. There are some specific concerns about the money, but people, and let me just say, quite frankly, whenever Black people get money, white folk always seem to have a problem about it. So, let Black Lives Matter have whatever money they can muster, but let them also respond to the needs of the people and not to the people. Let me put this another way. Let them respond to the needs of the people and not to the purse strings, to the people with the purse strings.
Got to say this, it was terrific catching up with you again. It's been about 6 months since we last spoke. I know people can find Cynthia on Facebook. Just look for Cynthia McKinney on Facebook. You'll find her there. She's on Twitter as well. In fact, as we're chatting away, I'm voyeuristically looking at some of the tweets that Cynthia's been putting out over the last couple of days. Cynthia is quite simply at Cynthia McKinney on Twitter. Follow her because she tweets out regularly there.
And also, I'm getting a new website, which people can bear with me. It's already up and running, but it's not quite 100%. And that is the same as before, but now it's up. www.allthingscynthiamckinney.com.
Allthingscynthiamckinney.com. Look, enjoy the rest of the summer. I'll give you a bell around about election time, maybe just after the election, and we can have a chat and you can give us the post-election analysis. Love chatting with you, Cynthia. You're absolutely amazing. Look after yourself.
Okay.
Good luck with the radio show, by the way. Good luck with the radio show. And I look forward to listening to that. Bye for now.
Bye-bye.
What's really interesting about that was recorded earlier on today, is that it follows the interview that I did with David Icke yesterday. And David talked at great lengths in the first 15-20 minutes of that chat yesterday about shades of grey and black and white. And if you listen back to that interview dispassionately, you'll hear Cynthia McKinney saying that she's interested in some of the policy pronouncements by Donald Trump and would agree with the US leaving Europe to deal with NATO for one and one or two other things. But she also conceded that it's not beyond the bounds of possibility that the Clintons have done secret deals with Donald Trump. And she talked about Bill Clinton maybe encouraging Donald Trump to run for president in this election. And she also talked about hearing about funding for Black Lives Matter and conceded that Soros's paws might be on that. But she also said that, you know, there are a lot of people who've connected themselves to Black Lives Matter who wouldn't know anything about George Soros or wouldn't know anything about the funding coming in there. They're regular black people and regular white people, it must be said, who attend these rallies, whom are just sick of seeing the ugly police brutality on television and on social media. And this is what David Icke is talking about when he talks about shades of grey. And it's what Paul Joseph Watson, God love him, and even David Duke, and she smacked me on the wrist for assuming that David Duke hasn't repented or recanted his Ku Klux Klan ways. Maybe she's right. I don't know David Duke personally. But this is what these people don't understand. And it's what much of those who either produce independent media or consume independent media don't understand. There are no absolutes and there is no black and white. There is a hidden hand that is manipulating events on this planet that desires an end game which will result in 5.5, maybe 6 billion of us to be eliminated, to be wiped off the planet. These are the people promoting the vaccines. These are the people polluting the seas, poisoning the rivers. These are the people pushing GMO foods on us, designing Terminator seeds, designing seeds that can survive in soil which has been disrupted by abiotic stress. All of this is related, and every single one of us on planet Earth is targeted. Not blacks, whites, Hispanics, Jews, Christians, every single one of us. I was absolutely thrilled listening to that, listening to how she can say, well, I think this about that person, but I can see that there's another side to it here as well. I just find it remarkable. And maybe it's needed. Now, a number of you said on Twitter that, you know, Cynthia is still maybe clinging to the idea that there is a solution within public life. Well, look, she also said that there isn't in the same interview. And she is a woman whose father was a congressman. She was a two-time congresswoman for Georgia. She comes from that background, doesn't she? And she's always bound to, I suppose, defer to it and refer to it in interviews like those. I think she's an amazing woman. All things CynthiaMcKinney.com. That is where you'll find her online.